Welcome to Biophilia, the love for nature in all her manifestations. From the tiniest organism to the greatest red giant floating in the farthest realm of the universe. With biophilia comes a restless curiosity, an urge to investigate and discover the elusive places where we meet nature. We are on the brink of a revolution that will reunite humans with nature through new technological innovations. Until we get there, prepare, explore biophilia.
Iceland, November 2010. And early choir rehearsals are underway in preparation for a three-year world tour.
Og það kemur af mismunandi stöðum en hjá öllum það er svolítið flott ég veit ekki hvað það gerir
ég
bara
setja
áherslu á þú veist, bara þegar það mynd það bara fó
Even Björk's all-female choir is unconventional. Many have trained together since they were 6 years old. They've been chosen for their remarkable sound and precision. Bringing together nature, technology, and music. She's called her album Biophilia, traveling from the outer reaches of the solar system to the inner worlds of cells. Björk will explore the science of sound, invent incredible instruments, create new forms of musical notation in her quest to use nature and technology to help us understand musical structure in a radical new way.
Seems to be around this about age that I'm now, that you have to make sort of spiritual statement.
With biophilia, Björk is seeking to discover a more natural and intuitive way for all of us to make music in the 21st century. And she has a surprising collaborator.
Welcome to biophilia, the love for nature in all her manifestations.
Like a virus.
In a very special encounter, Björk and Sir David Attenborough will discover what happens when their two worlds come face to face.
Well, this project was interesting for me because several reasons. I think at the end of the last project, I lost my voice and had the vocal nodule, and that's something I've overcome. And I didn't even know if I could sing again, so I had to sort of redefine that, eat different things, do different techniques. And then all the situation was happening in Iceland, the bank crash, and I got really involved in the environmental stuff here. So on so many different levels, there was this message that all the old system don't work anymore. You've got to clear your table and start from scratch, you know.
Today it's all our privilege to be able to hear from the creator of Biophilia herself about the inspirations, the journey, and the future possibilities of this incredible revolution in music. So it's an honour to share the stage with one of the most creative and inspirational women of our time, and I would like you all to please welcome Björk to the stage. Sit down. Unless you want to do it standing. How do you feel?
That's quite classy too. Yeah.
So Björk, welcome and thank you. Today I want to talk about three things with Björk, your inspirations and your working process. Biophilia and how that came to be, and beyond biophilia, so how the project has evolved into what is really a living toolkit for learning about music. So let's start at the beginning, your inspiration, nature, science and technology, how those have always been fundamental to you, even as a child.
Thank you. a lot of my sort of inspiration in how sort of music and sound functions is very much built upon when I was a kid. I would walk 40 minutes to school and back, any weather. And my little way of dealing with it is just sort of sing. And that would be when I was walking in nature, kind of on my own. So for me, the line blurs so easily between music and nature, because that's almost like the same thing for me.
First of all, just tell me about this inspiration from nature, because we don't necessarily listen to your music at different times in your career and think nature. Tell me what the connection is for you.
Well, for me, like when you listen to music, you have structures in it. Like I've never really been able to relate to like the rock and roll structure, which is for me is quite square and quite sort of. I mean, like literally geometrically square, right, square, not square,
fashionably square. Yeah.
So maybe because I wrote my melody by walking outside, and then if I walk down a hill, that's like the verse, and I go on top of the hill, and that's the chorus. So it's kind of quite spatial and quite related to the landscape, like the arrangement.
So you need a lot of hills so that you have choruses and verses.
Björk wants to redefine how we can make music in the 21st century. But to do that, we must first go back to understand its origins. She has come to London's Natural History Museum, where a fan has offered to give her a guided tour.
Hey. How nice to see you.
Good to see you.
You like this place?
Yes. It's very epic.
It's a great place. There's everything here, from microbes to man to minerals, everything. It looks like a cathedral, doesn't it? The first director was very keen that it should be a cathedral in praise of creation.
With 58 million animals and 9 million fossils, it's the biggest natural history collection in the world.
And those are birds of paradise. Isn't that extraordinary? That's a headdress nearly three times the length of your body. You've probably done that.
Yeah, right.
What?
Yeah, definitely.
Bjork is here because of what we can learn about the evolution of singing from the animal kingdom.
By and large, the more beautiful the bird, the simpler its music, the simpler its call. And there's a lyrebird. See the beautiful tail it's got?
Yeah.
The lyrebird song is probably the most complex bird song ever.
Is that the one that you see on YouTube imitating mobile phones?
That's it. That's the very one.
Oh, wow.
Because part of the way it shows off, where it explains to the female how clever he is and how wonderful he is not only by making music, but by imitating everybody else's music. So that if you listen in the bush in southern Australia, you may think you're surrounded by 10 different species, but they're all actually made by that lyrebird singing the same song.
And the lyrebird doesn't just mimic other birds. Its repertoire includes car alarms. And chainsaws. Not unlike Björk, it's developed a phenomenal vocal range, which offers a clue to the importance and purpose of singing.
Your voice is a very odd voice, Bjork, isn't it? I mean, really. The fact that your larynx can produce this extraordinary range of sound, it can't be just an accident. That range of sound was, at one time or another, valuable and functional. and that you are exploiting it in a way which would have made sense ancestrally.
That makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
That actually the human larynx is capable of so much more variety of sound than is required for language. And that, to a biologist, would mean that there was a function of the human voice which preceded language.
Mm-hmm.
So that it's actually singing is more fundamental to us than speaking.
So we were actually born all free jazz singers, but we're just chatting
yes.
away.
Yes, it is.
So how do you think music works for us now, the modern people?
Well, one is absolutely clear, and that is the sexuality of music. I mean, in, as it were, classical times, troubadours singing up to their lady loves up on the balcony, come and join me, or let me come in. But in our own culture now, I mean, pop music is hugely sexual. There can't be any doubt about that. And that's why it is so popular amongst people of between 15 and 30. I mean, that's the peak of sexuality, and it's the peak of the passion about music.
But it's not just about sex. Even our animal cousins are expressing something less functional.
Gibbons have one of the loveliest songs and loveliest animal music in the whole animal kingdom. When a male and female get together, a pair forms, and when that happens, they sing together. And the great song of the Gibbons is highly complex, and both male and female take part in it. And I find that very touching. But whether it's touching or not, it seems to me incontrovertibly beautiful. They don't know it's beautiful, they're just exulting. The mystery to me is how music has been used by humanity to take us beyond territory, beyond sexuality, into something that is transcendental.
Let's take one step back,
yeah.
Because it's really interesting, because it's such a broad scope, this project. Let's take one step back and go to the songwriting process, because it starts with songs.
Yeah.
It all begins with the song. So you started talking to scientists about nature, you went to the National Geographic Convention, to the research process, the real kind of fundamental learnings that you did to inspire the lyrics, the songs, and then the elements that the songs ascribe themselves to. Talk us a little bit about the research period. It's very fascinating to hear your stories about Nat Geo and MIT and stuff like that.
Yeah, I went, I think it was the summer of 2009, June, I went to the National Geographic Explorer convention, which is, I think, the most exciting thing I've done. I watched in 3 days 100 lectures.
I think they told me you got the world record for sitting through the most amount of speakers out of anybody that's ever visited. They even bestowed the honour of giving you an Explorer's, I don't know, like Explorer in Sound Award or something.
Yeah. I was just really, really inspired and just thought it was just a really different way of approaching things, and probably also really refreshing for me, you know, being in the pop world for so long. And I also started visiting MIT around the same time, and so I went for a couple of visits to them.
What were you looking for there? What was drawing you there, and what kind of things were you seeing there?
I wasn't really sure. It was more like a gut feeling. And it's been really the spirit of the Biophilia project has really been that any, like many, many moments, I have like 20 options in front of me and I can only pick one. It's been really sort of like a very gut feeling kind of driven thing. But then in the end, I met many people from MIT and ended up working with one of them doing one pendulum. But in the beginning, I didn't know that, you know.
You were searching, you were curious, you were trying to learn and discover more, and then you would find the thing that clicked with you and with the song and develop more intensely the relationship around one song with one creative partner or collaborator.
All our senses come from nature. Our reactions come from nature. The obvious stimulus that you can think of nature, or inspiration that comes from nature, is because you feel that flower is beautiful, or you feel that that bird soaring in the sky is beautiful. It's not nature, it's the feeling of the composer about nature. And if you had a composer who was insensitive to the beauties of nature, didn't matter how photographically he reproduced the sound, as it were, it wouldn't be worth a tuppence.
This music is from the Sea Interludes by Benjamin Britten.
That seems to me clearly to represent the rivulet, the waves just trickling up the shore and then trickling back. And that presumably is the mighty ocean behind. It's not just painting a picture of nature, it's much more important than that. It is a human being talking to a human being. It is not a human being talking to a landscape and a mountain. It is Britten speaking to you.
But Björk isn't just inspired by how nature feels. She's inspired by what it is, how it's structured. Overturning convention, Björk wants to bring nature itself into her compositions. With this song, Crystalline, Björk uses the similarities between musical structures and the structures of crystals to create a song which mirrors the form of its subject. And what better place to explore them than in the Natural History Museum's massive crystal room?
Wow, that slush, it looks like some sort of a forest.
Quartz. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. A reflection of the shape of the silica dioxide molecule. All packed together. The molecules will be, as it were, six-sided. So when they pack together, they form these six-sided shapes. And it's amazing how many people won't believe that these aren't man-made. You know, they think, how could that actually happen in nature? And I think that's miraculous.
For me, it's quite interesting how the range of crystals, how like totally different they can look, really hard and merciless, but then really fragile and pretty, yeah. You know?
But this six-sided basis, I mean, the basis of mathematics lies at the heart of crystals. And does it? Mathematics lies at the heart of your many of your songs, doesn't it, really? I mean, because it's about the spheres, it's about the universe, it's about the fundamental things like mathematics.
Yeah, and kind of has an inner logic.
Yes.
To it.
A basic structure, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, also, of course, I mean, beats in the bar. I mean, you could have 3 beats in a bar or 2 beats in a bar or 4 beats in the bar, and there's a mathematical basis, isn't there, to bars? And there's a mathematical basis to crystals.
Yeah, that's why it sort of seems a very natural fit. Like this would be a 6-8 kind of song.
In Crystalline, Björk has turned the structure of crystals into an unusual combination of time signatures.
The verses are in 17-8, and then in the chorus it sort of goes into 4-4, and then it's like a square, more like a square.
Absolutely, or in this instance, a cube.
Yeah.
Now Björk's choir must learn how to actually sing it.
Crystalline,
Biophilia's musical director, Matt Robertson, guides them.
That makes it really easy or really complicated. So if you're a counting type person, that's how to do it. If you're a listening type person, then you just have to listen to it.
On the screens here, a list of songs, and each corresponds to an element. So maybe it's worth, in order to kind of bring a little bit of clarity to the process, to talk through the stages of, say, Thunderbolt or Moon.
So basically, there's 10 songs, and I started with mapping out the 10 basic musicology elements. Like, for example, there's chords, scales, rhythm, counterpoint, arpeggios. There's kind of like 10 of those. And then I found whatever is most similar in shape, in nature, to those musicology elements, and in order to make it simple for kids. So basically you are...
That's a key point.
Yeah. Right?
Keeping it simple was a key point for you, so it could become something that was accessible for all ages.
Yeah. So basically, for example, with arpeggios, which are like broken chords, I match them up with lightnings because they are most similar in shape. And then when you show a kid a lightning, and then especially like what we did with the Tesla coil, you can actually hear it as well. And it sounds the way it looks. Then people, kids can get a musicology element much quicker. It's just like they can get something in 2 minutes, what would take them a year to learn in school.
How does this not get in the way or interrupt you just trying to make a beautiful song coming from the heart, from yourself? Was there not a kind of a conflict where there was design over emotion? Or did you find the two things managed to balance themselves out?
I think so, because it took me 5 years to do this, you can try a lot of things, and for you it doesn't click unless you have the right song with the right element, with the right musicology, with the right lyric. So I think that's where also, maybe also I could especially do it in this project, because the whole theme of this project is about connecting the dots. Yeah. It's not so much about that each thing is original, or it's more about building bridges between things that haven't had bridges between them before.
After 3 months of rehearsing, Björk's choir are getting closer to mastering her compositions. But this is just the beginning. Björk still has to find a way to turn her ambitions for harnessing the power of the natural world into a radical musical performance.
Mathematics, I wish I was a mathematician, which I'm not. But you sense the beauty. I know a mathematician will talk about the beauty of an equation.
Mm-hmm.
And you can sense that when you hear a five-part fugue mm-hmm. by Bach, which also has a mathematical beauty. And the fact that you look at crystals and have called one of your compositions crystalline, because it is about the mathematics, the fundamental mathematics, which is the foundation of so much in the natural world, and of so much which is sublime. Symmetry is an element in musical structure, and it's an element in visual structure.
From the microscopic to the galactic, our universe consists of remarkable patterns. Music is also made up of patterns, but these are usually only heard, not seen. Björk wants to change that. She wants to find ways of visualizing sound so that we can understand the ways in which it works. Evan Grant works with cymatics, the science of turning sound into images.
What I've got here in front of me is what's called a Chladni plate. What it is a glorified speaker, really. In the same way that your speaker can move like this to resonate and pump sound out to you, this can do that, but it has a post attached to this plate. So I can vibrate this plate. By covering this with sand, I can then play a frequency into this, and these patterns will start to emerge. When we visualize sound through it, the lower frequencies or the lower pitches are simpler, the patterns are simpler and less complex. And as we go up in frequency or up in pitch, they get more complex, more dense, arguably more beautiful. All around us, things are vibrating and changing and shifting. And cymatics is like this window into that, enables us to reveal these things that we couldn't normally see. Where do these patterns come from? There's no trickery here. There's no complex science here. I'm just literally vibrating something. And all of a sudden, these seemingly endless, stunning, geometric patterns emerge. One of the things I love about Bjork and her approach to music is that she's very scientific. She takes this very holistic approach. She looks at everything. She digs into the world and into existence to try and bring real substance and real meaning to her music. And so it was a fascinating idea for me to try and visualize one of her tracks using cymatics in water.
And this is what crystalline looks like when we see all the components of the song visualized. As well as hearing crystalline gives it an extra dimension. And it's this extra dimension that is driving Björk towards her next and most dramatic challenge, to find a way to bring nature onto the stage with her for the first performance of Biophilia. March 2011, and Björk is in a small metal workshop near the Thames estuary. She's come to meet Henry Dagg, a sound sculptor who's created one of the world's most unusual instruments, the sharpsichord.
I feel you compress hair into a small space.
This solar-powered instrument is a cross between a harp and a barrel organ. It's taken him 5 years to build. It's programmed by putting pins into a steel cylinder. With 11,500 holes to choose from, it takes a day to program just a minute of music.
I didn't do right the phrasing.
No, you. I think you were a bar behind.
Yeah, I know.
On the,
I know
on
what
the B section. Yeah.
I have to. I'll work it out. Yeah,
it's in the same key, and it would harmonize with that extra line. So, I can run it until it ends.
June 2011. Final rehearsals before the world premiere of Biophilia at the Manchester International Festival. Henry Dagg has brought his 2.5-ton sharpsichord. It's the only one in the world.
Are we doing on that top cornice?
Yeah, we're okay.
The sharpsichord?
Yeah.
I'll give that to you. Man, that's what I'm
saying.
Yeah. Wow. People are mörg, mörg ára smíða. Yeah. Svo ætlar að bjóða hann að, ég get sagt þú íslenska, en eiginlega ekki, ætlar að bjóða hann að kaupa það. Og hann ekki kynna alltaf ykkur ástæði, þú veist. Það tíma ekki að láta að fara.
Það ógislega gaman.
Það
ógislega.
Is it solar power?
What is today?
Not in England.
No.
And then there's the, there's the gamelan as well, which is a, which is another fabulous instrument, which is a sort of a hybrid that you created from an original a gamelan, which, if people don't know, is a sort of a Balinesian instrument, right? That's usually played by many, many players simultaneously.
Yeah, I guess the.
I've never heard of it before. You told me what it was.
Yeah, it's basically a pipe organ and a gamelest. Those were built by an Icelandic music organ builder. So the pipe organ is basically a MIDI-controlled pipe organ. So that's maybe not that unusual, but maybe the gamelest. And that was more of a static reason. I took my old Celeste because at that point, there was no money. And we tore, gutted it and put instead bronze bars, which is like the same, which is in gamelan. And then we MIDI controlled it.
We're trying to do a month's work in about a week and a half.
I'm blinded by them.
is.